thank you for your interest in the Purdue Veterinary Nursing Distance Learning, or VNDL, program. My name is Daniel Mickelson, and I'm an academic advisor with the program, and I'm joined by Josh Clark, the assistant director of the VNDL program. We've prepared this presentation to answer general questions for anyone considering applying for the VNDL program. As part of this presentation, we will cover several different topics. We'll cover pathways to complete the program, our admission standards, credits per semester required for financial aid, online learning, course formats, hours of study, clinical mentorships, VTNE pass rates, study abroad, and several other topics that are of interest to students interested in this program. To start off, though, we do like to make students aware that a veterinary nursing program does not lead to a DVM program. Students wanting to pursue vet school or becoming a doctor of veterinary medicine should pursue a different undergraduate degree, because this degree does not fulfill the prerequisite requirements to enter into a DVM program. But one of the first things we do like to cover is just what you can expect from your pathway in our program. Our program is very flexible. We are an associates only program. You will receive
you'll receive an associate in applied science degree in veterinary technology, or veterinary nursing. Right.
I do know that most of the time. But we have several different pathways you can take to achieve that. As the PowerPoint says, that we have a 3-year plan of study and a 6-year plan of study that are laid out for you. You can follow them exactly. But honestly, what most of our students end up doing is some combination of both, a variable program based on your needs and your life each semester. And you will have an academic advisor who will help guide you through creating a pathway that best fits you and your life circumstances. The fastest someone can complete our program, though, is 3 years. And that is a tough 3 years. That is a lot of credits, a lot of work. You're looking at around 20 to 25 hours of study per week, every week, for 3 years straight, which is not for everyone and not recommended for students who are working high stress or full-time jobs that require a lot out of them. While it is possible, not something we super recommend. But yeah, let's go to the next slide, Josh. So to move on, our program does have some very specific admission standards, mainly based off high school education or equivalent. You are required to have graduated high school or have an equivalent such as a GED. One of the big requirements that we have is that you have to have done 6 semesters of science, specifically 2 of biology and 2 of chemistry. This is where most of our students get tripped up, is either that biology requirement or that chemistry requirement. These can be supplemented by going to a community college in your area and completing 1 semester of a lab bio to cover that 2 semesters of high school biology, or 1 semester of lab chemistry to cover the 2 semesters high school chemistry requirement. Those do have to be lab courses. And if you have additional questions about that specifically, and if your situation needs those additional courses, we really recommend reaching out to our admissions officers here at Purdue, and we'll have their contact information later on in the PowerPoint. In addition to that science requirement, we do require that you have completed 8 semesters of English, 6 semesters of academic math, and you will need to have an SAT or ACT score that you will submit to us. There is no specific requirement for what that score should be. You just need to have showed that you have completed either the SAT or ACT. Unless you have completed 24 credit hours in college or are 23 years of age or older. Our admissions application is open from September 1st to June 1st. And we have our several different admissions deadlines listed below. The first one for the spring semester listed is November 1st. You have to apply by November 1st in order to be admitted for the spring semester, April 1st for the summer semester, and June 1st for the fall semester. And those are rolling admissions decisions. And so you can apply, let's say September 1st, you could apply for spring, summer, or fall. But you do have to have those admissions applications completed by those requisite deadlines. Another thing we like to touch on, and we are not experts in financial aid. There are a lot of nuances to financial aid. And so if you have additional questions after seeing this video about your specific situation, we encourage you to reach out to the email below, facontact@purdue.edu. But we will provide you some general information about tuition and financial aid options in this video. Your tuition for the new program is a flat $270 per credit hour. That is the same for everyone, whether they be Indiana residents, out-of-state residents, or international students. And that is a flat fee. There's no additional fees on top of that. The only other thing you really have to pay for in this program is books, and that cost is very minimal. So $270 per credit hour, you can calculate that out for however many credits you're going to take. That is the exact cost of your tuition for each particular semester you're in. In order to qualify for federal student loans, which is the primary source of financial aid that our students access, you need to be enrolled in at least 6 credit hours per semester. That can be anywhere from 2 to 5 courses, depending on how many credits each of those courses cover. For example, we have courses that are as little as a half a credit course up to 3 credit courses. And so depending on the semester, how you meet that 6 credit hour requirement can vary drastically in the number of courses you're enrolled in. For federal Pell Grants, you can take any number of credits, and the Pell Grant allotment will just vary depending on how many credits you're enrolled in. Scholarships and private loans are a little bit different. They will have specific guidelines depending on the scholarship or private loan provider. And if you are looking to use either one of those services, we recommend reaching out to those particular providers for additional details about whether what amount of credits you would need to be taking or what their specific stipulations are. Additionally, we do obviously allow cash payments for the program. Many of our students do pay out of pocket for this program. And to help with that, we do allow setting up payment plans through our university bursar's office. You can set up a four payment plan or a 5 payment plan to spread those payments out throughout the semester that you are in. And like I said, for more specific questions, you can reach out to our financial aid office here on campus. And now I'm going to turn some time over to Josh, who will cover some of the more course-focused information that we have.
All right. Thank you, Daniel. I'm going to talk a little bit about some common challenges first with online learning. And one of the challenges is actually kind of a myth that a lot of students have, in that they kind of believe that online courses are going to be easier than traditional courses that they would take in a classroom. And that is absolutely not the case. Online courses are definitely more flexible and convenient, but they're not easier. Another challenge that students experience is time management. With that flexibility and convenience, it also can be a little more easy to procrastinate, which you'll see on the next bullet there. And there's also that feeling of isolation sometimes too, just because you're not surrounded by classmates, you're not meeting regularly with your instructor, and things like that. So it can be a challenge sometimes to manage your time, just because a lot of the students in our program are working full-time and have other family and life obligations, and so then you have to work in time to study on top of that. Our course formats, we use Brightspace. That's the learning management system, or LMS, that we use. If you've never used Brightspace, that's not a problem. Most of the learning management systems are similar, and it's fairly easy to learn and learn how to navigate through your courses in Brightspace. Our courses are all asynchronous, and what that means is there's not any requirement for students to be logged on at specific times and days of the week. So you can log on when it's convenient for you, access the courses and the course content, the exams, homework, and things like that whenever it's convenient. Now, we do have instructors that will, from time to time throughout the semester, have live Zoom sessions. And they try to plan those when, maybe in the evenings when more students can attend. But those sessions are not required. Those are sessions that are optional for students to attend if they want to, and typically instructors will record those and make them available for any students that can't attend those sessions. Most of our courses are broken up into modules, so they're kind of chunks of material. Each module might contain, learning objectives for the content in that module, maybe textbook reading assignments, links to other websites, some lecture videos, and some other activities, homeworks, and things like that. We use Respondus Lockdown Browser for exam proctoring for all of our courses. That's a free software. You don't have to pay any fees to use Respondus Lockdown Browser. It's free to any Purdue students to use. You don't have to schedule times in advance to take your exams. The only requirement is that you have to have a working webcam on your computer to use Respondus Lockdown Browser. And the last bullet here talks a little bit about the time you should set aside for studying. And this is pretty closely related to the time management bullet that we talked about previously. We tell students that they should expect to spend a minimum of 3 hours of study time per week per credit hour that they're enrolled. So as an example, if you were enrolled in 5 credit hours, you should expect to spend a minimum of 15 hours of study per week. Okay, and by study, that includes really anything you would do in the course as far as reading, studying, taking exams, completing homework, and so on. Okay, let's go on to the next slide here. Okay, so our program is kind of broken down into two parts. We have our online courses, which are kind of what I just talked about. They're broken down into modules. You'd have textbook readings and maybe homework assignments and exams to complete. The other part of our program are what we call clinical mentorship courses. These are the courses in the program where you essentially prove to us that you have the hands-on skills that you will need to be a credentialed veterinary technician. So the mentorship courses are task-based, they're not time-based. And what that means is in each of the 18 mentorship courses, there's a specific list of tasks that you have to complete. And basically, once you go through and you complete all those tasks satisfactorily, then you've completed that clinical mentorship. And the clinical mentorships are completed at a veterinary facility that's local to you in your area. You do have to have either a doctor of veterinary medicine or a credentialed veterinary technician to serve as your mentor at that facility. And then, as I've said, the mentorships consist of a series of tasks that have to be completed multiple times and have to be observed by your mentor, either DVM or RVT. And we do require that most of the tasks be videotaped, so you can upload those videos directly into Brightspace. And then our instructors here at Purdue are the ones that watch those videos and then make the final decision of yes, the student did that task correctly, or no, there was something wrong and the student needs to redo the task. And so this slide just has an example of some of the requirements of one of our clinical mentorship courses. So you can see kind of on the left side of the screen there, this is basically any of the clinical mentorship courses have a list of required equipment and supplies that the student will need to have access to in order to complete the mentorship. And so on the left side of the screen, you can see for this mentorship, there is a list of supplies. This is a pharmacy mentorship, so it deals with filling prescriptions and things like that. And then over to the right side of the slide is the list of tasks for this specific mentorship. And so you can see here there's 7 different tasks, and then some of our mentorships also have some projects as well that aren't necessarily hands-on tasks. All of our mentorships, all 18 of our mentorships, have a logbook. Those logbooks can be are all posted on our veterinary nursing website, so any prospective student can go and look at the logbooks and look at the different types of tasks that you would have to complete in the mentorships, as well as looking at the different types of equipment and supplies that you'll need to have access to. Another thing that I like to talk about with our program is the veterinary technician national exam that is taken to become a credentialed veterinary technician. This is the exam that you have to take that's the national exam to be credentialed. In some states, you might also have to take a state exam. That varies state by state. So, for example, in the state of Indiana, to become a veterinary technician, you do have to also take a state jurisprudence exam that covers the various laws covering the practice of veterinary medicine in the state. In the majority of states, you must graduate from an AVMA accredited veterinary technology or veterinary nursing program to be eligible for the VTNE or the Veterinary Technician National Exam. And we do like to tell students that or tell prospective students that right now our VTNE pass rate for the VNDL program is 96%. That average fluctuates some because there's three windows during the year that graduates can take that. So we update our score three different times a year. And so it does fluctuate. What I can say is that generally speaking, our pass rate is 90% or above. But it does fluctuate some with the three different testing windows that are offered every year. Okay, and I'm going to turn it back over to Daniel now.
Thank you, Josh. So to close out here with this video, we do like to mention some of the benefits of being a Purdue student. First here, I have listed three different offices that are available to our online students, just like they're available to our on-campus students. We have the Academic Success Center, which is built and designed to help students be successful as students. So it's there to help you with things like test-taking skills, study skills, time management, and all those other things that may be difficult for you because it's just, they're not normal things. And if you've been out of school for a while, you're out of practice, and they're there to help you manage those kind of things. We also have a Disability Resource Center for any students who may deal with learning disabilities or other things of that nature. They're there to help you navigate the complex waters of getting accommodations or other things that you need to help you be as successful as possible in our program. Additionally, we do have a Counseling and Wellness Center in our college. It is there to help students who are struggling mentally with their wellness, etc. And they are always there to chat. If they can't treat you specifically because you don't live in Indiana, they also are able to refer you to other places, help you find the help that you need, in addition to providing many, many different online resources that are accessible to all Purdue students. Additionally, one of the fun things that we like to mention about our program is that we do have study abroad options for our distance learning students. So not only can you participate in this program from anywhere, but you can also take a chance to study abroad. Right now, we have two study abroad trips that are running. One is in Guatemala. The other is a Japan trip. The Guatemala trip specifically, you go down to Guatemala for about 10 days and you work with a wildlife rehabilitation facility down there. And you get in cages with crocodiles and do blood draws. That is something that I would never want to do, but apparently some people enjoy that. And we encourage our students to take advantage of those opportunities as they come. But right now, Josh, let's go to that last slide. That is all the information we have to share today. We want to thank you for taking the time to watch this video. And if you would like additional information, we encourage you to reach out to vetadmissions@purdue.edu, where you will be put in contact with someone who can answer those questions and provide you any additional information that you want. If you are applying to the program and have questions about the admissions application, we encourage you to reach out to admissions@purdue.edu. That is the office that handles all of our admissions applications directly. And then, like I said earlier in the presentation, if you have questions about financial aid or anything to deal with your specific situation and financial aid, please feel free to reach out to facontact@purdue.edu. Once again, thank you so much for watching this video, and we look forward to having you in our program.
Thanks, everyone.